It's 12 o'clock on a Wednesday and this is the Wizard Product Review. I'm Dave.
I'm Craig. Glamour's back.
And on this week's show.
On this week's show, first up, one of the most hotly contested, highly anticipated.
This is what happens when you film shows at 6 in the morning.
Absolutely. One of the most highly anticipated DVDs. It's another Shin Lim one.
Is it going to be an iconic DVD release?
Well, we will see. You know what? I defended iClear. I thought that was very good.
What do you mean you defended it? We were having some kind of argument. I liked it as well.
But a lot of people are on the Shin warpath. If you've read the forums and stuff,
right,
a lot of people are like, I liked iClear. Unfortunately, we've gone from the lofty heights of iClear to somewhere around about the same level as Triple S. He's taken the barrel.
Triple S a triple bucks price as well.
Yeah. He's taken the barrel that he scraped with Triple S. He's moved the barrel. He's dug up underneath about 10 foot down. He's found a new barrel and he's currently digging in that one.
Well, you get a lot of stuff on this DVD though, Craig.
Yeah,
a lot of tricks. A lot of tricks. First of all, iMove.
Da, da, da,
da, da. Oh, big shout out to the music on the DVD as well.
Yeah. It was really like listening to an explanation of a trick in a nightclub.
You're just like, can we get out of the nightclub and listen to the explanation?
Here's the thing, Shane, you want to play around with the audio levels on the background.
We can't hear you. Like, I'm always an advocate. I say, like, a DVD, all it does is replace a set of instructions. But actually...
Having said
you
that,
know,
Dave,
you've got to get the volume right,
if there ever was a DVD when it didn't matter whether you could hear the instructions or not, it would probably be this one, to be perfectly honest.
Yeah, because you're not going to bother to watch it again anyway.
Imagine iLogo. You remember iLogo, where you move the Apple...
Oh, that thing with their phone.
Yeah, when you take their phone, it was brilliant. Yeah. We talked about it last week.
That's
week
not
before.
This, no.
No, no. if you watch the trailer on the TV, if you watch the trailer and you went, that's too good to be true. Yeah, you're right, it's too good to be true. Let's synopsis.
First of all, he sees it going around on a table, first of all, before it changes to an apple. I don't believe you can do that well.
No, you can't.
On the DVD, he says, oh, I had it set up a different way when I did the trailer and I was doing it this way. I don't think you could have this control over it.
Didn't demonstrate that.
He didn't demonstrate that. But I don't run out of time or something, you know, on the DVD. But when he's holding it, yes, you can see it moving around and then it changes to an apple. But like you said, instantly you're going to go, can I have a look at that?
Well, my two main issues with
the routine I'd structured for iLogo was at the end, the way I did it was I showed the creator of iLogo this thing. And at the end, I took my phone, put it back-to-back with theirs and cloned the logo, kind of like a wild card
thing. Yeah, which worked really well.
Because I just used to make the logo disappear.
Yeah, I remember that, yeah.
And I preferred that to moving it. The animation's too much. No, forget about it.
Well, my issue with iMove is the same issue that I've got with every single one of these tricks, which is twofold. First of all, you've got a major arts and craft project in order to get the thing set up.
It's no longer the paper crane moment, it's the Shin moment.
Oh yeah, it's no longer the paper crane moment, you're right.
This has gone beyond, because you get the two gaff phones.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong, it's worthwhile, like, Extreme Burn. You have to put some effort in to make that thing up, and that was worth it. With this, it's just taking it to the next level. And we'll talk about a routine on here later on, where it takes setup to the next level. You need to be in the kitchen. We'll go into that later on. But honestly, the setup for it is ridiculous. I don't understand why you didn't just supply the gaffs. You get a particular gaff, you spend 45 minutes
with a screwdriver, which you have to go out and buy and get. And that, you might have one already, and then you've got to be sticking, and then you've got to be spraying. By the way, according to John, don't spray it if you got this gimmick, because it just doesn't work. We've already had people in touch, haven't you, John, saying, like, I sprayed mine and it's ruined it.
I love the moment where he says on the DVD, now, my gimmick doesn't look so good because I use black Sharpie. Well, why didn't you, if you're filming a magic DVD and it's an explanation and you want to show people how it looks...
It sounds like, remember, we did like iClear. Remember this, because it sounds, you know, like we're so being
maybe,
so hard
Shin,
on the guy.
Maybe what you want to do is you want to actually put the gaff together how you want people to do it so they can see how effective or not it looks.
iPick was probably the best one, where you could borrow their phone, show the camera on one side and move the camera to the other side. He did have a move where he kind of flicked it like this.
And the reason that's the best one And herein lies the second problem I had, is because it can use a borrowed phone. My issue with all of these routines, except iPick, and even iPick, he does it with his own phone, but he talks about how he can do it with the spectator's phone.
Yeah.
But my issue with all of these routines...
Probably the most commercial effect.
They look incredible when you're looking at them. They look incredible. But you are left with an incredibly gaff phone. You're left with not an iPhone. If they, not in any way, shape or form, if they closely examined it or even picked it up, they would realise it's not a phone. And you cannot switch it for a normal phone because let's say you've made the iLogo, let's say you've made your logo disappear.
There's so much heat
turned
on it
into
at that
an
point.
Apple. Yeah.
There's the heat on it then. It's
yeah,
like
but even if you were a sleight of hand god and you could actually switch the phone.
Or got a check shirt.
Yeah, or got a check shirt, which, Jim, that ain't going to work, mate. Close up. I'm telling you right now.
It's a bit of a stage minute. We'll get to that in a minute. Yeah.
Not going to work. And even if it did work, do you really want to go out dressed like that to do a magic trick? Probably not. But my point is...
What about iCash?
Oh, it was crap.
So basically, you fold up a bill on their hand, wave your phone over the top, and it changes. There are so many bill changers out there. It's almost like crowbarring a bill change onto the DVD with a gaff phone. You know, once again, 20 minutes arts and crafts project, and that's when it's edited down to create a bill change.
And then,
that's
and
not
then the
that
phone
good.
Can't be examined. Nothing can be examined. You do this amazing routine where
the bill,
things are flying around
the
all over the
clean.
Place, and then you're done. You can't examine
like
the phone.
It. I didn't like this. Eye scratch. Oh my god. Right, you get the gaff phone with the DVD. I'm sure you've seen the trailer, guys. It starts with him getting his Doc Martin and going like that on the back and going like this. That's going to ruin the back of the phone.
Yep.
So what do you do? Yeah, that's not your presentation, but he doesn't really say how to do it without stepping on it. So what do you do? Go and then go, look, it's all cracked.
Yep.
But I don't think the gaff looked very good on the video when you
were
looking
says,
at it for a long
this
time.
This is the routine I was telling you about where he actually says,
yeah, I know.
Mine doesn't look so good because I did it with Sharpie.
So it doesn't inspire you with a lot of confidence, but also on the explanation, on the performance on the video, when you see it and it's restored, it cuts quite quickly. So you don't get kind of a long look at it. Whereas surely in the real world, if you've got a cracked iPhone, you just go bang and it changes.
Now let me
people
put that
gonna,
away very quickly.
People are going to go, "What? Yeah, I need to check. Where's the scratchers gone? It's not so good."
They're going to accept you putting it away in your pocket just to bring it out. And then we have Eye Vanish, which is what we alluded to earlier. It says perfect for stage or parlor. I think it's perfect for stage when you're in the O2 arena and like
it uses techniques used by stage manipulators. It reminds me of a tie that Dan Garrett used to wear all the time, blew me away with years ago. I think it was at the international convention where he made a coin vanish.
It's Johnny Wong.
It goes back beyond that,
really?
I think. I can remember this when I was a kid and that kind of thing. But it's that kind of principle, if you know what we're alluding to. But yeah, you need to spend time gaffing things up, and it really suits a stage manipulator. Finally, iBite.
Oh,
our favourite.
Oh, this is awesome. If you've seen it, he takes a chunk of the phone out and throws it back. Same issues as before in the when you do this and throw it back, they're going to want to look at the phone.
So it's like
it's
bit and coin with your phone.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Oh, the setup, Shin, you're just opening up a whole world.
Do your parents know you're doing this sort of thing?
Shin, I'm a little bit concerned about you. This is like one
this
step
is
away
dangerous.
From being a pyrotechnic. I'm going to explain something here.
You can't give anything away. How do you say that?
I'm going to try.
Well,
we can say heating
up knives on grills.
During
and
the setup of the trick, in order to prepare the gimmick, you have to follow along with Shin. And what he suggests you do, and he does it with you, is he goes into his kitchen, he turns on the hob in the kitchen.
We're not going to say what for.
No, we won't say what for, but he turns on the hob in the kitchen. He takes a kitchen knife, he starts heating up the kitchen knife, and then doing something with it.
But he does say, to be safe, wear marigolds.
Yeah, wear rubber gloves. I'm telling you, Shim, rubber gloves ain't going to cut it right there. You almost cut your own thumb off. And by the way, if you're going to do something absolutely
cut away
like
from
this.
Yourself.
Yeah, if you're going to take a kitchen knife and heat the bloody thing up and then start cutting something, don't cut towards your thumb. It's just absolutely ridiculous. It's just stupid.
Or your next arts and crafts project might take a little bit longer.
I understand why you've done it. It's probably because you didn't want to go to the expense of creating a custom gaff for this trick. So and you know that people haven't got the necessary equipment.
That kind of finishes the whole thing off, doesn't it? It's like, you get gaffs, but
If anybody on the Wizard Pro Review is watching this and does, but please don't do that. Even if you're over 18, just don't do that. It's stupid. You're going to hurt yourself.
And I don't think the effect's that great either. Look, we love iClear. If you're looking for a great effect to do with your iPhone, get iClear. Don't get this. This is lots and lots of effects. The one with the camera phone moving is okay. It's a visual vanish. It happens in a snap, and you can do it with their phone. That's the only one that I personally think is okay. All the rest, I just would not touch. And they're just too much hassle to set up. I love Shin's stuff. He's one of the most creative magicians on the planet, but not this time.
He reminds me of a Star Trek movie. You know, they are either really, really good or really, really bad. And normally they alternate. And, you know, the iClear was really good.
Yeah.
This is really bad. So his next release is going to be good.
Right.
I know.
We've still got to check out the Switch at some point.
Yeah,
we'll
get around to that.
How much are you going to give this?
1%. 1%.
It's got to get... I'll give it more than that for the camera one. But how many effects are on there? Five? So
six.
Six? Right, so I've got to give it... Oh, my God. I'll give it about 19%.
Bad luck.
So, are you ready for a challenge?
This is stuff that would make Ponta the Smith's eyes bleed. The Coin of Wildness. Holy Cow, which stands for Coin of Wildness by Chef Tsao.
I thought it was just what you said while you were watching the explanations.
We'll get this for a quote. It's a very exciting DVD. I got a lot of inspiration from it. Ponta the Smith.
So
now, when you get one of the world's greatest coin manipulators...
When that geese has been inspired by a DVD, it might be worth having a look at.
Absolutely.
Can we synopsisize? There's a major technique on this that I've never seen before explained on DVD.
Yeah, I mean, it's not just this technique. There is a whole bunch of other stuff on there, but he does go into arming. I've seen stuff similar to that before, but not done in this way. He goes into it in great detail. Basically, what we have here, guys, is you have probably the most technically advanced coin DVD I've ever seen, but...
Which is why I'm not going to touch it with a barge pole. But there you go.
But it is the most astounding visual magic that I've ever seen. And despite being technically demanding, it's super commercial in that... It's not angly really that much other than a couple of bits.
Before we talk about effects, I was going to bring this up about angles.
Okay, go on.
Well, isn't it a bit angly?
Not really, no. Well, first of all, I know what you're thinking about. The arming stuff can be considered a bit angly. Only, however, if people are looking down at you. Think about if you were in a restaurant or you're in a corporate dinner and people are looking up.
Right, okay.
They're not going to see a thing.
Yeah.
For the situation...
And it does look amazing
on video.
For
the environment that you work in,
yeah.
Corporate dinners, yeah. It's perfect from an angle point of view. And it's only angly for the stuff with arming. Everything else, there's no angles with it at all.
Can you synopsisize some of the moves, some of the individual effects?
It's very commercial material. It is going to take a lot of time.
I'll tell you what. Let's just stick one effect. We'll actually break and just let's have a look at this first. The first.
Yeah,
move.
This is called Holy Cow.
So that's Holy Cow. Now that is just like absolute. It's kind of like it just
it's
morphs.
A one-handed change with a regular coin. You take a coin, boom, it changes. It is really that good. Come on, if you were going, you say you wouldn't touch it with a barge pole, but surely, Dave,
that's
you owe it.
I'm lazy.
You owe it to your audience to do the best possible type of magic that you can do. And if you're going to do magic with coins, and you do magic with coins,
sometimes,
and you want to change one coin into another, are you going to do a spellbound change? Or are you going to do that?
I think it's absolutely amazing.
It's absolutely amazing.
I'm frightened. The truth of it is, can I say this? I'm actually scared by it.
Yeah?
I was watching the explanations and I'm scared.
Well, you see, I was watching the explanations and I was like, this is the most inspiring stuff I've ever seen. I want to just not film the show. I just want to sit there and learn this stuff. I really do. And I haven't felt this
excited. We'll never see you again.
Yeah, I haven't felt this excited about learning new coin magic.
What was the next thing on the DVD?
Since I learned all of the stuff off Rune Clan's DVD. Holy Cow Blur, which was an amazing vanish. It is the perfect retention vanish. You take a coin, you put it in your hand, it goes.
You do
and the
see
reason
it
is,
go into
the
his
reason
hand.
You see it going into your hand is because it actually does go into your hand. The technique for vanishing the coin, I've never seen anything quite like this before. It actually goes into the hand and then vanishes. Forget about false transfers, forget about retention vanishes, forget about classic palm, puts and takes, whatever. This is the ultimate
and
way to vanish
the coin.
He
does do it live in front of spectators. You see him outworking it as well.
Yeah. Then you've got Holy Cow Vanish. Yeah, there's live performances of quite a few of the routines. Holy Cow Illusion is probably the weakest routine on the DVD. Basically, it's a vanish and a reproduction of a coin.
I didn't like that as much.
The finale of it is quite nice. He snaps his finger and it goes. And that's kind of a variation on the Holy Cow Vanish. But it's still worth study. But, you know, it's probably the weakest effect. And what makes me think that is because the next routine is Chef's Coin 2.0.
Was that now, the hand-washing thing?
It's a flurry,
you're just like,
basically.
Where the hell is the coin?
Yeah, basically what's happening is you're doing a flurry. But and I do flurries in my work, as a lot of you will probably know. And this flurry is just unbelievable. It's not a case of, look, if I put it over here, it's over here, put it over here, over here. It's just like, boom, it's jumped. Now it's vanished, now my hand's completely empty, now it's back. Oh, it's just like, what?
Even when you know about the techniques on the DVD, you're still watching it going, hang on, yep. I can't follow this.
Then you have two coins across, Invisible Move and Invisible Move 2.0. Invisible Move is best looked at from above, looking down. It kind of, in a way, reminds me of a little bit like Jay Sankey's Mr. Clean Coins Across, but it's way more visual than that.
Yep.
And you're not using a pointing transfer or anything like that. They look like they're literally going, but it's that sort of angles. But it looks really good. And he's got a multiple click
everything
pass.
Everything is
he's,
incredibly
yeah, he's
visual.
He's got a multiple click pass in there.
Do you have to
you
wear the outfit?
Believe. No, you don't have to wear...
Well, you don't have to wear the outfit.
All short sleeved.
Oh, yeah, everything's short sleeved. He looks a little bit like a really thin Mr. T. without the gold chains, but that sort of top. You've then got Invisible Move 2.0, which is a three fly. I've got to be honest, he hasn't really added anything to the three fly plot. It's not a bad three fly, but I don't think it...
The techniques
the
he's
level.
Using,
yeah.
Further it, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Invisible Hole, however, is the best, I'm going on record right now saying it is the best coin in glass routine I've ever seen. It's multiple coin
I
in glass.
I couldn't work that out. I could not work that out.
No, it's great. He's utilising a lot of the techniques he's taught throughout the DVD. Literally three coins, boom, 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 one at a time into a borrowed glass. And by the way, guys, no gaffes. At any point in any of these.
Yeah,
there's
no gaffes.
No shells, no flippers, no double-siders, nothing. No gaffes. That coin in glass is brilliant.
What
now,
was the one with the three copper
I'm getting
coins
onto there
and
now.
The three silver
Silver
ones.
Centipede.
Right, this was the point where you had to remind me about no gaffes.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, oh, yeah, well, of course, it's this.
He was convinced that we're using copper silvers. But I was
it
like,
can't
no,
be done.
It can be done. Anybody who's seen Curtis Cam's work knows it can be done. But this and I love Curtis... This even went further than his goblet stuff in terms of wild coin. He's got three coins, right? Three silver coins. One at a time, they change to copper with one hand. One-handed changes into copper until all three of them have turned copper.
I was convinced there
and
were
then
copper
they all
silver,
turn silver
gimmicks or something.
And if Curtis is watching this, or if anybody's watching this and they know Curtis, you want to tell him to study this because he's done a lot of work on the wild coin. And I think that this has just taken it to an entirely new level. Really,
can I
really
mention,
visual.
Sorry, before you leave that as well, I don't want to forget. I really like how the explanations were done as well because you kind of got a graphic in the corner.
Yeah, you did.
With hands in the corner, and it helped you to keep track of what coins were palmed where.
Yeah.
I've never actually seen that on a DVD before.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really clever. So at the same time as following along with the video, in the corner is your left hand and your right hand, and what's in each hand at the same time, but in graphic form.
Yeah.
I thought that was a really nice touch for an instructional part of the DVD.
Very good, so you can keep track of where the things are the whole time, which you need in these routines. The final routine is Cow Spellbound, which is a multiple phase one coin spellbound routine, which reminded me a little bit of Pontus Spellbound, And I never thought I'd say this. It's better than Ponta Spellbound. If you ever saw the Spellbound routine that Ponta used to make a name for himself, this is This is even better than that. The coin is literally, he's taking all the routine, all of the techniques he's taught throughout the DVD, and he's combining them into one long Spellbound routine that will literally make you look like a god. Literally, if you learnt half of these routines, and then you went to Blackpool, and you just sat in the bar, and just was doing this,
you'd
kill somebody.
He's the sort of guy, you go to Magic Live, and which is becoming my favourite Magic convention now, so I keep referring to it. But you go to Magic Live, and you're up at 1 a.m, you think, I'll get an early night, and then you run into that guy.
And you're there till 5.
Just going, what?
Absolutely.
Show me again.
It's, this is the bottom line from my point of view. There's certain coin magicians who I hold in very high regard. People who I think have evolved coin magic.
Handling of the coin unique.
No. You have people like David Roth.
Yeah.
Michael Rubenstein, but then you've got all the modern masters as well, like Garrett Thomas and Eric Jones, and then you've got Kyan Harbottle, you've got Rune Klan, even Jay Sankey with his early stuff, you've got Curtis Camp, all of these people, even Reed McClintock, all of these people have done something with coin magic and taken it to a new level, and I think that Chef is right up there with each and every one of them. I think that this has taken modern coin magic as we know it and has moved it a step further.
I've never seen you so excited about learning new coin magic.
That's because I have my own coin stuff and I do my own coin stuff and I've studied coin magic, as you know, for years, but there's nothing really that's come out of recent years that's made me want to kind of crack out the DVD and really study it. This stuff, I'm incredibly excited about wanting to learn how this stuff works. It's really moved coin magic forward.
Before you mark this, I've got to say, I can't give this a high mark. So although I watched it, I enjoyed the DVD. Anything in the 90s is saying I'm going to do it. And I've got to be honest with the viewers.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed watching it. The explanations are first class. If you're into this sort of stuff and you're into your coin magic, yeah, you would give it a great mark. I can't give it a great high mark, but I did think it was awesome. What's our grade? If it's in the 90s, we're going to do it?
We're going to do it, yeah.
Well, I have to give it 89%, because it's like, if I was into it and I wanted to do it, you know.
Well, but, I can't argue with that. I am going to do this. I am going to study it. It's going to be a while before I do it, but I'm definitely going to study it and I will eventually do it. I think this DVD is as important today as the stuff that Roth bought out in the 70s. That's
really
how, yeah, I think that this is going to move coin magic forward just like Roth did in the 70s when he started coming up with
and do you edge, think people are going to be inspired like you? Do you think they're going to get this DVD and they're going to learn it?
If anybody has studied coin magic, if anybody has done one coin trick, if you go out and you perform one coin trick, even if it's a really simple coin trick, whatever it may be, I know there's guys out there and they go, oh, I only do one coin trick, I do a 3-5, whatever it may be, if you do coin magic, you appreciate how important coin magic is to an audience and you know the value of how it works, you have to buy this DVD. You have to buy this DVD. And I know there's going to be people out there that are going to buy this and are going to study it and are going to create a massive reputation for themselves. And
I feel bad, but I'll just give it 89%.
Well, I'm giving it 100% because I'm going to do it. I love it. And more importantly, I think it has evolved coin magic to another level. I think that this DVD is simply unmissable if you study coin magic, you perform coin magic, or more importantly, if you want to entertain your audience and you want to do strong magic, whether you do coin magic or not, if you want to really
be... It's not for everybody.
Obviously, if you're lazy and you don't want to put the time and effort in and you don't really want to entertain your audiences, then fine, don't worry, be like Dave. But if you want to take this to the next level and you really, really, really want to blow your audiences away, you have to do this.
Not 100%.
100%. Oh, I think it needs to get Worker of the Week as well.
Well, I can't give it Worker of the Week. I'm not going to work it.
Well, I am. We'll get Worker of the Week. We'll give it half Worker of the Week. Put a little half logo up there. Do it now. Right there. Okay? Thank you. Right. Half logo of the week. I'm giving it Worker of the Week. He's not. But I think this is the best DVD I've ever seen to date. And that's the bottom line, because I said so.
Superfly by
Actually,
Scott
before we
Alexander.
Talk about Superfly, in the break I was chatting to
John. Oh, you
were
talking to John. Yeah,
and we've worked out it's going to get a worker special because it's a worker of the week. Me and John have decided...
It's not my worker of the week.
Don't care. Me and John have decided that if you get cow before midnight on Friday... That's right, John, midnight on Friday, right? Yeah. If you get cow and order it before midnight on Friday, we will send you Locked in a Room Without Coins absolutely free of charge. So that...
If you ever get bored with
coin magic, you can take a break and learn some cards.
That'd be pretty quick for me, but there you go.
So, if you order this... Worker special.
Dave,
get locked in the room.
Beth, or Andy will add it to your order
Absolutely.
Automatically.
Yep.
You're not seeing anything on the site. It will be added to your order automatically.
So Superfly.
Cards across for how much money?
it's very expensive.
It's a lot of cash.
You know what? This isn't just a review for me. I have actually. Well,
you're emotionally involved with this.
I'm emotionally involved. I actually ordered this.
Steady on.
And the reason I ordered this is because I was looking for a Cards Across to do in a stage environment for a long time to put in a slightly unusual show. And I'm a big, massive fan of Scott Alexander's work.
Well, everything that he does is worked. It's tried and tested.
And it's not designed for a close-up guy.
Yeah, you can see it. It's a stage performance of Cards Across. There's some clever... I've got to admit, when I first started watching it, I was watching the DVD, and the routine did, from a routine perspective, seem to take a little bit of time to gather pace, the first part. Yeah, there's some nice gags and that kind of thing. But as soon as he got into the bit where he was telling the guy where to, you know, I need you to hide the envelope, like you're going through customs and that kind of thing, it started to really gather pace. Until the end of it, I was thinking... This is great. This is so entertaining.
And it's an 11-minute routine.
Can you synopsisize the routine in basic
absolutely.
Form? Obviously, we can't tell you all the gags. We can't put too much footage on the screen because, obviously, that's what Scott is selling. He's selling
absolutely.
His routine. The methodology behind everything...
It's
incredibly easy, yeah.
All you need is this and a pack of cards inside your... Yo, thanks, Craig, Scott. proof. There you go, right there. All you need is this and this in your case and you're good to go. Takes up no space in your case whatsoever.
And one other gimmick we're not showing.
You get a pack of cards, which at the end you give that pack of cards to the volunteer that's come up and helped you on stage.
Synopsisize the whole effect.
You have somebody come up, they count 10 cards out for you very cleanly. They take the deck, they count 10 cards. You then tell them to examine an envelope, they examine the envelope, they take the 10 cards that they counted and they put them in the envelope themselves, they seal the envelope and they sign the envelope.
Sign the envelope, yeah.
You then tell them to put the envelope where, even if imagine the envelope's £10,000 in cash, and imagine you were going through customs, where would you put that envelope so that even if you're going through customs, they wouldn't get it?
Yeah,
Scott talks about audience management and how to make
Some
sure this
great
happens
tips
every time.
On the DVD,
tons
about
of tips,
how to get the spectators to act a certain way.
Yeah, absolutely.
You don't just get lucky, he's thought about every single thing to get these reactions.
And it's almost like he was psychic, because as I was watching the DVD, I was thinking, well, what if this happens? And then he was in his next sentence, it was like, you're probably thinking, well, actually, I am, Scott. So they take the envelope, they shove it down their pants.
Next guy comes out.
He then counts another 10 cards out.
Yes, sorry.
So he takes another 10 cards and he says, go out into the audience and get 3 people to pick cards. And he's got some really funny lines and really funny moments there. So 3 people pick cards. He then has the 3 cards shuffled back into the pack and brought back up on stage. He then takes
back into the pile, not back, back into the pack.
Yeah, back into the pile. So he's taken these 10 cards, 3 people have picked cards, and he's shuffled them back into this packet of 10 cards. And
sorry, I realised where I got ahead.
Yeah, so then the 10 cards are put into the envelope, and again, he examines the envelope, he puts the 10 cards in the envelope. And then you have somebody else come up from the audience.
Yeah.
You give them that envelope, you get them to sign that envelope, and they shove it down their pants as well. So you've got a situation, 2 people on stage, think about how clean that is.
Yeah.
And by the way, this is completely...
Apart from shoving it down your pants,
there's no work, there's no palming or anything like that. Very, very easy to do. So then... This is the funniest part. The whole thing's hilarious. He's like, right, we're going to make three cards go from over here over to here. And I'll talk briefly about this because he does show it on the trailer, so we're not giving much away.
And the music makes
Yeah,
it
the
and
music
kind of
and the classical music. And he has this handkerchief and he stands behind the guy on the left. He stands behind the guy on the left. And all of a sudden, it just starts. I just laugh thinking about it. It's hilarious. Like this. And it's just one, two. You'll see the clips on the screen, but it's the funniest thing. Honestly, you can, the audience, it's shot in front of a live audience. You can hear them reacting. It is a hilarious moment. It's really funny. And then when the third card has gone across, and I've never really seen a routine like Cards Across before where you've got that visual moment of the cards gone.
No, that's
normally
true.
Normally it's a pantomime thing. I remember John Lenihan, he had that lovely slim slam.
Yeah.
And that was nice, but this is even better. You know, it's just like boom, boom. Beeping going on somewhere. Boom. Then the music goes off and he comes forward and it's an applause cue right there. It's just fantastic. And then he gets the first guy to... They take out their envelopes. They rip open the envelopes. They take out the cards. And he says, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 cards. Only 7 cards. They count them themselves. There's only 7. He says, what was your card? 3 of clubs. 4 of hearts. 7 of diamonds. Whatever they may be. Is it there? No. Is it there? No. Is it there? No. All 3 cards have gone. Fantastic. The routine's really building.
Yeah.
And then he takes the second guy. Count the cards. 13 cards. But hang on a second. Is there a 7 of diamonds? There is. Is there a 3 of clubs? There is. Is there a king of clubs? There is. 3 cards gone across. And it's just building and building and building and building.
A full stage routine that would fit inside a very, very small space, very light. The routine is very well structured. I think because I knew it was a cards across, and I didn't know anything about the routine because you kind of sat me down, you'd already seen it because it was your thing and you said, right, watch this. I was kind of thinking, you know, where's the bit that makes it unique? As soon as those bits came in, I was like, ah, yeah, this is good.
Yeah.
It's entertaining. It's not going to impress magicians from a methodology point of view.
Yep.
But anybody that can look past that and just wants a good, solid, entertaining routine, they're going to find something here. But they're going to have to pay a lot of money for it.
Well, that's the thing. One thing to take before we talk about that... there's a lot of... It's designed for an adult audience. There's a lot of innuendo and jokes like that. But he talks about how you could adapt it to a family audience. For a kids show, you can do the same thing.
Yeah.
It's great for kids entertainers, because traditionally, and I don't mean to put kids entertainers into a certain category, but from my experience, a lot of kids entertainers kind of shun away from sleight of hand.
Yeah.
Which is fine. Absolutely not a problem. But this routine, there's no sleight of hand, no palming, no nothing like that. But you can have them hold the cards above their hands and you can still do the whole hanky thing and you get that moment. And it for kids in the audience, it's like a zombie ball. It's fantastic.
Yeah, it does. It does look brilliant.
So it works for the family audience. It is incredibly expensive, especially for what you get. You don't get a great deal in the box.
How much are you going to give it?
Well, you know what? Again, we relate to the marking system. Am I going to do this? That's why I bought it. I did like months of research before I bought this. And I know I'm going to do this. I bought it specifically to put into my act. I know exactly where it's going.
How much are you going to give it?
For me, I'm going to give it 96%. I think it's absolutely brilliant. It's a stage routine that packs completely flat. We talk about the close-up guys.
Yeah.
And a great thing to do is to have put together a little 20-minute cabaret that you can sell as an add-on to your show.
Yeah.
If you can put something like this together into a case and you can sell a 20-minute cabaret show afterwards or a half-an-hour cabaret show, this just literally is this in your case.
And for an audience where everybody knows each other as well, like a corporate, and they know the two guys out there.
Yeah.
Very funny indeed. I'll give it 93%. Great work. Once again, another Scott Alexander product that did not disappoint. That's it this week for the Wizard Product Review. We've certainly had some highs. We've certainly had some lows. You'll always get our honest opinions. Join us next week, 12 o'clock on a Wednesday. I'm Dave.
And I'm Craig.
See you next week.
That's 2 weeks off and he forgets his cue.